so my other juice,
maybe.
So
you can roll the leg in and see how does that feel. Okay. How does that feel on this side? Oh. So what I'm noticing is that neither of Kirsten's legs are particularly enthusiastic about rolling in.
So
but
many
I would
people.
Say that her left leg has a little bit more bounce in the internal rotation, right? And this side, it's sorry, we're not doing that today. Okay, that's an indicator that actually I'm thinking both psoas are probably tight because it was resistance on both sides, but it was more resistant here. Now, you may need to chart in your practice, and you may need to record which psoas muscle was more tight. But if you don't, just release both, okay? Don't worry about it. So another thing that the psoas can do, if it's tight, right, it's going from here down to here, is it can actually pull the hip up a little bit, mm-hmm. right? Like so.
You don't have to do it. Thank you.
So it could make the leg look a little shorter. Mm-hmm. The leg fits into the hip. It's like a camshaft. So when the hip rolls backwards like that, right, it takes the leg with it. So the leg, you please don't. Just
I didn't.
Okay.
I mean, I didn't.
Okay. So the leg may appear to be shorter down here just because the hip has rolled backwards or has scooched up higher, all right? Conversely, the other leg might look longer. So if there's a leg length difference, it could indicate that the psoas has come to the party. So I'm going to just take a look at her feet and see if there's a difference in her leg length. And there could be, might not be. Or it might be her ilium is rotated. I don't know yet. It's just yet another indicator. So I'm going to bring, ooh, soft. Bring her ankles together and compare her leg length. This leg appears shorter. This leg appears longer. So I've got suggestion on both sides now that, and once again, it could be both sides. So there's another indicator, alrighty? We have an indicator point for the psoas. If this point is hot, it could be that their psoas is affected. You find the point, you find the belly button, and you go to the ASIS. You draw a line between the two on both sides. On the right side of the body, this is also called McBurney's point. Somebody asked me about that yesterday. If this point is active, right, if you press into it and then they have pain when you release, that is an indication that the appendix is pissed off. Okay.
Mm-hmm. What was that point called again?
McBurney's, and you only have one on the right side of your body. However, there's a psoas indicator point on either side. On the right here, on the left here. So basically we're right over the psoas, right? Although we have some squiggly bits in between, you know. So as I press in, either one sensitive, Kirsten?
The one on the left a little more.
Her left side is a little bit more sensitive. But that being said, that could be what she ate for dinner last night, making its way through. You know, it's hard to know. So once again, it could be many things. So don't totally rely on that, okay? Next one, moving of the rib cage. This will look familiar from yesterday. Yay, familiar. Check the movement of your rib cage, moving towards me. I'm going to go around to the other side of the table, so I do sort of an equal test. Pulling towards me. Oh, look at that, right? Mm-hmm. So the right side of Kirsten's rib cage moves towards the midline more easily. So that suggests that this psoas is tighter than the other one. If you think about a bow, and I know that there are lots of people around here who do bows and arrows and stuff, right? If you imagine the rigid wood of the bow with the bowstring, it makes a letter D, right? Mm-hmm. And there's the bowstring. Now, if I push on the wooden bow towards the string, nothing's going to happen, is it? If I go on the side of the string and push towards the wood of the bow, the ends of the bow will flex a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. That's sort of like the spine is the wood and the psoas is the bowstring. So in the body, whatever side of the rib cage moves towards the middle the most easily is the psoas that is more tight. Got it?
Mm-hmm.
Great. Now we have one more thing to look at for the psoas, and that's arm length. If the psoas is tight, and remember, it is connected to the bottom of our rib cage, we won't be able to stretch above our head as far on that side because it's pulling our rib cage down. So we can check arm length. So can I have your arms? And once again, if somebody has a shoulder issue, this isn't the test. Because you don't want to be pulling. Let your elbows relax. Let your shoulders relax. Okay. I want to get a fair test. So I'm not going to pull with my arms because I'll just find out that my right arm is stronger. So I'm going to stand back from the table until my arms are completely extended. I'm holding her wrist and I'm just going to lean back. There's the pull, equal on both sides. Now point your fingers at me, Kirsten, and I'm going to put her hands together. And then we'll see which arm is shorter. So her left arm is a little shorter than her right arm. You can relax. So that suggests to me that, again, the psoas in this side is a little tighter on the other side. Okay? Sometimes you'll see it quite dramatically. Can I have your hands again? The trick is not to be tricky yourself. Okay? I stand back, stretch my arms out, point your fingers. Now, if I put our arms together over here, obviously, I'm going to make it look like something else. If the hands are over here, it's going to look like something else. So when I do this, I usually look at their belly button area, and I don't look at their hands when I put their hands together so that I don't trick myself, and I keep her in line. And then we come up. And just a very subtle difference here, not much. Here you go. So we have a lot of information here, don't we? And basically what we figured out is that there's active indicators on both sides. So I would say, let's reduce both sides. Any questions about the indicators, the assessment? Thank you very much for listening to that. I'm going to be honest with you right now. I rarely do the assessment. I just release the psoas on each side of their body and carry on because most of the time it's going to be tight anyway. So I do both sides. But you might work in a clinic where you really need to document very, very carefully, or it might be an insurance case. And so then you do want to know these things. You do want to document. Especially if you're a PT or an OT, you have to do an assessment and then document change. So checking these indicators and noting them in your notes allows you then to document the change afterwards. So for some folks, it's very important, so I wanted to include it. Okay? So going to page 5, I'm going to show you a couple of ways to release the psoas. Okay. The first one I call the side bending position. So again, if psoas is tight, it's going to be pulling our rib cage down. It's going to be kind of side bending us a little bit. So that can happen. So let's just check in with this leg that doesn't really want to turn. So let's do the side bending. Release on the side, okay? Here's it. All right. So what I'd like you to do is to drop your shoulder and side bend on the table. Yeah. Are you comfy there? Mm-hmm. Okay. So I got her to side bend. I'm exaggerating her pattern, right? From the top of the psoas. You just rest the hand. Okay. And now I'm going to exaggerate the side bend from the bottom. I'm going to bring her leg to the edge of the table, right? That's called abduction. Moving away from the midline is abduction. Moving towards the midline is adduction, Jenna. Okay? So we abduct the leg, and then I'm going to externally rotate it just a little bit more because that's what it wants to do. I'm going to step in here with my leg, and I'm going to lean right up her leg, and you're going to watch her hand move as the compression gets there. See that? Mm-hmm. This is the release. I'm killing myself.
In the book, they have you grab the hand.
I know. I'm going to talk about that.
Okay.
That's why I don't like the book.
Yeah, I know.
I broke
confuses
my hand.
Me.
People grabbing my hand makes me very uncomfortable. Ah, there we go. So I'm going to return her leg to the starting position. And you can unside bend, darling. Okay. So here's the thing. Arthur had arms for days, legs for days, right? Mm-hmm. Kathy Kane, who wrote that book, is 6'2". Okay. People with really long arms can actually reach the hand. The way Arthur used to do this technique, and I never liked it, just keeping it real, he'd turn the leg out to the side, he'd stand here and say, give me your hand. I'm not going to do it.
Right. And then
give me your hand. And then he'd pull them into a side bend, and he'd push up and pull down at the same time.
That's now, hard on your body.
For him, nothing was hard. He played rugby. He was indestructible. Okay? But for me, I can't do that comfortably. And as a massage therapist, I really hate having my wrists pulled on. I really don't like it. And I found that it works just as well to just rest. Can we just side bend on?
There you go.
Just side bend them a little bit. Then externally rotate the leg, laterally rotating the hip. Step in and compress up. It's working. Mm-hmm. Trust me.
And you're pressing your knee against the ball of your foot, right?
Actually, it's my thigh.
Your thighs.
Mm-hmm. I'm just, what I'm doing is her foot is here direct. And I'm doing that
mm-hmm.
with my body. That's it.
It's a direct line.
It's like a line. Now, if they have a knee issue, they're probably not going to appreciate that. Okay? So what you might do instead is let your knee bend. Put your foot on the table. I gotcha.
It hurts.
You better here?
Mm-hmm.
And compress. With her side bend. That's a way to modify that for somebody with knee trouble. Okay. All right. Let's return to return your seat back to its upper position. Okay. All right. Now let's just see. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A lot more freedom here. And I'm not going to check all the indicators yet because I have another release to show you. Okay. That's one release. I'm going to show you another release on this side. So let's try spots. And this one is going to be real familiar. It's in your outline. It's the knees up position. Okay. So would you put your feet on the table and bend your knees for me? Both knees, please. Okay. Let me just rest that nice hand right there. Keep your tummy wide. I'm going to put my leg on the table to provide support for my client. Take your knees up and rest them here. And now I'm going to feel for neutral. Where's the place for her legs? Where it feels the easiest in all directions, like neutral on a stick shift. Mm-hmm. So right about there, are you comfortable?
Mm-hmm.
And I can supply compression or I can just wait. I know this looks like L1 and L2 release. It's very similar. But this release also affects the psoas. Mm-hmm. The difference is I'm not monitoring a point. And actually, she wants to come over a little bit more and a little bit more. How's that? So this is another psoas release. This feels lovely, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't even look like you're doing anything.
That's true of all orthobiology.
Would you also go with it when it starts releasing, like kind of like an unwinding sort of move?
Sometimes we'll end up in what we call phase 5, where they start to spontaneously adjust their position. And then I just support them and go into where they want to go. Yeah. So right about here, and she's way done. So let me bring your legs down. I don't want her psoas to recontract. All right, so I'm going to gently put your feet down, and then we'll slide your legs down. Okay. Now something about your clients, if they come in and the first thing they say is, I got to have a pillow under my knees, they're telling you that their psoas is tight.
Mm-hmm.
Release their psoas and they'll no longer feel the need for a bolster under their knees. And it also leads me to an interesting thought, right? If Janet Travell could put a bunny out of alignment by keeping it in a position that didn't serve it for 10 minutes, what happens when you have a massage and you have a bolster under your knees for a half an hour? It tightens up your psoas. Okay.
Oh, wow.
Just a thought. Okay. Now look at this. Boinga, 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 boinga. Boinga, 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 boinga. Let's see if your leg length's changed. Your leg length is much closer to balanced than it was. There's a slight difference still, but not as much as before. And we already can see that it's easier for her to roll her legs in, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's
so that means I can't move anymore?
Oh, no. No, it sort of means that you're going to move with style and grace.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And let's look at that now, huh? Look how. Okay.
Last night I got out of the car and did a couple of 360s because it was
pause,
so
please.
Icy.
Pause, please. And your saw is tightened up. Because you were in survival mode then.
Well, at
right?
first I thought, God, I just ruined everything that MJ
said. Honest to God, just thinking about that has made you so as reconturned on your fingers.
But my thought went to was like, thank God I can spin and dance like
there
this.
There you go, let it go. Let it
with the work that we did, or all otherwise right. I would have fallen.
All right. Now, one more thing I want to show you is a way I would do a one-legged psoas release. I showed you one way. I'll show you just another way. Bring the leg out. See how I put my knee on the table to support it right here? You comfy here? And now I just lean down the leg.
Yeah. Is this what you did when I came in?
Yes.
Okay, because that was absolutely
this is a one-legged psoas release. I can do one leg. And then I can go to the other side. And I can do the other leg.
Yeah, because that was absolutely
like so. Fantastic. See how she's supported? I've got her here. I can compress. I'm not hurting the knee. Feels nice. Mm-hmm. Quick and easy, ba-dum-ba-dum-ba-dum. We're done. Let's move on to something else, right? Mm-hmm. That's because most of my clients, I don't have to document the indicators or my assessment. I can just in my notes say, release psoas bilaterally, and I'm good for gold.
So really, that's the same position as when you had her side bending.
Similar, but she's not side bending.
Right.
Right.
It's similar. But if you wanted to do the side bending position and they couldn't tolerate the pressure up the leg to the knee, right. I showed you how I'd modify that.
Right.
Now, if a client comes in to me and says, oh God, Morrell, there have been people in my face all day, I'm just sick of it. Do you think I want to do this? Or do you think I want to do this for them, right?
Right.
I want to meet them where they want to be met. Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to be in their face. I'm going to give them a little space.
The side bending too, you're also getting the QL a bit more.
You are a bit.
Which is.
But you know what? As long as we're talking about it and you guys are so smart, bend your knees up, please. Thank you. Right. So if we're doing an L1 or L2 release and we drop the legs over to the side, what's happened to QL? Right? There's a method to the madness and you're catching on. Mm-hmm. It's great. So any questions about that? I know I showed you a lot of indicators. They're in your outline. Don't sweat it. Be nice to notice them once. And then I want you to try 3 releases for your person, okay? I want you to do the side bend, turn the leg out, and compress up the leg. I want you to do the knees up position. And then I want you to try the one leg at a time position. All righty? And hopefully it won't take too long. I know it's a long demonstration, but lots